What's going on, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Kickin' It with Kachi, powered by a DC voice. Once again, I'm your host, Kachi the Analyst. And today we have legendary musical artist, instructor, and aficionado, RBIII. Thank you for coming in and kicking me, man. Thank you.
Man, appreciate you, Kachi, man. I'm honored to be here.
So obviously, you know, we gotta take it back to the beginning. Like you tapped into a lot of genres that I feel like people our age are just not really tapping into right now. You know what I'm saying? So let's get back into the beginning. Like, what got you into singing, got you into artistry? I'm thinking it's maybe starting with the church and let you take it from there.
Oh yeah. I know you didn't heard a little bit. You hear the church and everything I do. Absolutely. Yeah. Right. Can't escape that. So everybody on my mom's side sings. So for the longest time, I didn't even realize that like singing was a talent or like that couldn't sing. So yeah, my mom sings, my granny, she just make a joyful noise unto the Lord. It's not really quite singing, but you know, she do what she do.
Yeah, right.
My great grandmother, my brothers, aunts, cousins, everybody sings. So I just grew up with music, starting of course with gospel. And then that kind of transitioned to R&B and, you know, pop, neo soul, stuff like that. And then when I went to Howard, that's when I started studying jazz. That was a part of my major. And then now the music that you hear from me is just kind of like a blend of all of those things.
Right. Yeah. And getting back to the first thing, like, how has sort of creating this connection with music, how has it also allowed you to, you know, have that connection with your spiritual self, right? And that higher being and, you know, kind of walking in your purpose through your faith and through your religion?
Yeah. That's an excellent question. You jump right on in there, huh? Okay. So I truly believe that music is healing. For me, myself personally, I have witnessed how music can come in and it can make a almost desperate situation seem doable or seem like you can carry on. I've seen music come in, and of course it's easy to celebrate with music. And one of my favorite moments, or one of the moments that I really, I guess, began to understand what my gift is for and why it's here on this, you know, on this earth, is my best friend back in high school, his great grandmother was passing away, and I went up to the hospital to support him and his family. And of course they knew that I could sing from some of the theater shows and stuff we'd been in high school. And so they asked me to sing Amazing Grace to his great grandmother, because that was her favorite song to help her, you know, transition. And so I just remember, for the first time up until that point, I wasn't worried about, you know, trying to put on so that they think I could sing. I wasn't worried about trying to put some, I wasn't trying to put no runs in there. I was just literally, I remember just thinking like, you know, God, please just give her some peace and let, you know, just make this a smooth transition. And it was kind of like an out-of-body experience. And my friend and all of his family members, they still talk about that song to this day. And they talk about how so much peace filled the room. And it was like my voice was just this peace. So, so getting in tune and getting in touch and getting focused and intentional about my music and intentional about the messages that I'm pushing, about the words that I say, the things that I speak over myself and over others, it has directly, you know, keeps me connected, you know, to the Most High above. So absolutely.
And that's beautiful, you know what I'm saying? Like they say, you know, I got a praying grandmother as well. And she's always said, she's been to have me in the choir. She's been in the choir, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. They always say in the church, all those who sings for the Lord, they pray twice, right? It's that jubilation, that connection to music, that idea of human connection, that is so powerful in music, especially with the music that I believe that you make, right? Like today, like it's a lot of the rap, it's a lot of the R&B that is very sultry or maybe raunchy, and that also has its place in the industry as well. I don't believe that is lesser music, but I do believe nowadays that there is a call, there is some sort of a need for this soulful, this spiritual uplifting music that doesn't necessarily have to be tied to religion or this idea of faith, but as you said, this idea of peace, this idea of healing, this idea of restoration, right? So
absolutely. Right. I appreciate you saying that, bro. I really do.
I was listening to your music on my way home, actually. You know, it's crazy. Like I said, before we got into the interview, like today, like the bus is going crazy. I missed my stop. I'm like, oh my God, I'm getting frazzled. So I'm like, you know, I'm like, I have to do this interview anyway. Let me listen to a couple of his songs, you know, refresh my memory. Obviously, I've listened to it before, but refresh my memory for the interview. And like you said, it's the calming, right? The calming effect of, right, the smooth transitions, the jazz, the soul, the pop. right? The R&B, the gospel even, right? So now getting into the technical aspect of now making this something that you're pursuing a four-year degree, right? A lot of people have this idea of music as this passion project, but are very unaware of the technical and the studying behind it. So what was the experience in going through 4 years, right? While other people are having their dreams and their set plans of business and economics and engineering, you're taking a much more riskier path, right? And deciding to pursue, go all in with music. So what was the decision and what was the experience there?
So I was raised under this idea that there's nothing that I cannot achieve. There's nothing that I can't learn. If I just am I focused, I'm dedicated to it, then it's gonna pop. You know, that's just what I always believed about myself. So when I decided to pursue the arts full time, or like to make that my career, there was never really a moment where I felt like I don't know, or what if it doesn't, right, or anything
right,
like that.
Right.
And then the fact that I was on scholarship meant that my parents couldn't necessarily, you right. know, they weren't in control. It was, you know, so it was my decision. I definitely, I'm just courageous. I just think it's gonna work, you know. And yeah. So I did. I will say this too, though. I didn't do it in a way where it's like, okay, I'm just gonna go on American Idol or The Voice or one of those
right,
shows, and
right.
I'll be a superstar. Like you said, I took the time to train and to begin to understand and gain a level of mastery over my craft. I did study, you know, the business aspects of it as well, because a lot of artists, a lot of people who are creators, they don't fully live in the business of it all. They just want right. to do the create, which you know, because you're a creative as
yeah,
well, which you already
right,
know. So it's
right.
like, they just, you know, you want, I love to paint, or I love to sing, or I love to play. And it's like, yeah, we do, but you also got to love reading your contract, or you're going to be mad because you're going to be sitting in the dark. You know what I'm saying?
Right,
especially in,
right.
in that industry where integrity is scarce. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, that's essentially how I got there. I just went for it, studied hard, and made it to where I could not fail.
And honestly, that's beautiful. So what was the decision then? You say you have a background in gospel and then, you know, raising the church, and that's kind of what amplified, pun unintended, but your voice in music, right? So why jazz? What was the connection to jazz that made you want to really like master that genre of music?
Well, Howard only has classical and jazz.
Oh, really? Oh, I didn't even know. I wasn't in the fine arts, so now I know.
Yeah, so when I started as a musical theater major. So I was, my mind was okay, I'm going to be a triple threat. I'm going to sing, I'm going to dance, I'm going to act.
Musical theater. We know that. We're going to get into that,
too. Okay. No, you hyping me up, Clint. I'm about to come on here again. Let's get a part two going. Let's get a part two.
We definitely need to.
That's good. I was a musical theater major, and I didn't really know me. I had been in musicals, but I didn't really understand musical theater. So I just thought it was a triple threat training program. But to sing for musical theater singing and musical theater acting is very specific. It doesn't necessarily translate across all the different mediums and stuff. So I very quickly found that that's not really what I was looking for.
Right,
and I transitioned
right.
up to the third floor, which is music, where the music is. And so my options were classical or jazz. And jazz, in my mind, was closer to R&B, soul, gospel. So I was like, I'll do that. But I will say this, I'm very grateful, very, very, very grateful that it worked out the way that it did. Because by studying jazz, my ears were developed in a way, my understanding of music, the way that I'm able, some of the musical elements that are not as prevalent in pop or in even traditional R&B. Or gospel, all these things that make really masterful vocalists and musicians, they are not as prevalent in modern day contemporary music. So by me going back and studying those people, it gave me a foundation that a lot of people don't have. So I'm very grateful with how it turned out, but it really was just, I knew I didn't want to do no opera or no classical
stuff.
Yeah,
right.
It was my old option, you know.
And then now leaving Howard, right? Like you're going all across the country. You're doing vocals. You're doing background vocals for some of the biggest names, called Jasmine Sullivan. But you know what I'm saying? Like we're getting into a lot of these ideas now. Like that, what's the career like? What is the post grad? What is the decision that you make? And what kind of decision do you think that fine arts, especially music majors, should make? Because as we spoke about that business aspect, right, coming into the idea of this is not just now your passion, but now stepping forth and making this your professional career. What was that like for you in making those steps, and then, you know, seeing a lot of fruits of your labor come to fruition.
Yeah, so I do a few things. I read this book. I should have had the title of it, but it's basically The Business of Being a Full-Time Musician. And it's this guy who talks about all the different ways that you can diversify your income so that you can just do music full-time before you're the large, you know, Drake or Rihanna, you know, of the industry. And so part of that was things like teaching. So I started teaching music lessons. Part of those things was doing studio work. Yeah, it's studio work. So recording demos for people, doing parts, arranging backgrounds for people, all of those types of things. Of course, I started doing the corporate thing, which is performing with a band at weddings and corporate events, stuff like that. Yeah, all of that. It's really more so just continuing to study and build your craft and getting out there so people see you and know what you're capable of, and then networking, and then just being in the right space at the right time. Those opportunities will present themselves, and you'll be ready to optimize on them.
And I definitely want to get into one of those diversified income streams that you just talked about, RBIII Academy, right? Your personal academy in which you are teaching youth the joy and the beauty of musical vocals and instrumental, right? Like, you are the piano teacher and vocal teacher. You got a couple other teachers under your belt as well. What is the story behind not creating this academy, right? Like, a lot of people think about the Drakes and the Rihannas, but I don't think a lot of people think about their own music academy, you know?
I'll say they teaching me. That's the part you don't know. They teaching me. The kids teaching me. How it happened, when I first moved to Atlanta, I knew that I did not want to do anything too far outside of music or too far outside of what my dreams were. I didn't want to get caught up in a 9-to-5 or in a situation that was not in the realm that I knew that I've been called to be in. And so I started teaching lessons at a bunch of different studios. And then as I got more students and got more settled in the city, I started like, okay, well, I don't think I want to teach at that studio no more because maybe it's far, or maybe that studio, you know. So I started leaving those studios, but some of my parents would be like, Mr. Ricky, where you going? Oh, no, I'm coming with you. Wherever you go, we go.
Right.
So yeah. I kind of looked up, and at some point I was like, okay, I have enough students and at first I was just driving to all their houses, driving to everybody's house and teaching them in home. Then it got to the point where it's like, okay, this is kind of a lot, driving to everybody's house, and I think I have enough where I'm going to just take the leap of faith and just kind of do it on my own. Plus, when you get into the numbers, which I ain't going to quite jump in here. I was studying the business too now.
Right.
Which maybe you could say like that Southern hustle or whatever. When you look at the numbers, I didn't feel like it was a fair trade what I was being paid versus the work that I was doing and what the studios were charging. And even though I enjoyed the space, I thought the students were awesome and everything was cool, I just kind of was sitting there looking at it one day and was like, why am I, you getting, let's say 60, 70% of everything that's being brought in, maybe 80% of everything brought in. And all you did was provide a space for me to teach. I make the lesson plans, I'm teaching it. So it's like, I'm a bet on me. So that's what I did. I got a studio space, and then eventually over time, as more and more students came, I was blessed to be able to meet or recruit some other people who are really amazing at their gifts, have some mastery, and have a calling and a desire to invest in the next generation of musicians. And so now collectively, we're all sharing our gifts and we have children, but we also have adults too. So it's just really just people.
That's beautiful.
And one little small extra piece, what I love about it, what surprised me, is how much I've grown and how much I've learned from the children. Because I feel like God is so intentional about the students that he sends me and sends them. And he sends me students who who are in different stages of the journey that I went through. So sometimes, like, I have one student who's like a perfectionist. And he doesn't believe it's good if he makes a single mistake, and he just, you know, and so seeing him and sowing seeds of encouragement to him and trying to get him to understand that a mistake doesn't mean that it's bad, and all of a sudden I'm talking to me, you know what I mean? Or this student, and it's like you get to see, because I don't have any children, at least not yet. And so it's like these become little small pieces of me that I get to be faced with. And then grow from. So it's really dope. I truly, truly, truly love it. I really love it. really
and that's great. I mean, I work with youth as well, so I work with middle schoolers. So though I can't go in the middle without them wanting to teach me something, because you know how teenagers get. They know everything.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
They know everything. So, okay. Exactly.
So, and that's beautiful. You know, like you said, like those moments of where the student is a perfectionist, or maybe they're hung up on a mistake. You're talking to yourself because you realize, oh wow, I used to be hung up with that mistake just the same. But now look, me, I'm fine, you know? So You are yourself your own living testament, as you say. And then that kind of goes into the other aspect, right, of this relationship building that you're building through music, right? Dollars for Scholars, right? This nonprofit foundation that you've created to further now provide support and resources for young people in your area. So tell us the story behind that and the experience that you had in sort of developing that and bringing that to life.
Yeah, I actually started Dollars for Scholars back when we were at Howard. So, again, I went to Howard fully on scholarships, but not necessarily from the school. I had just accumulated so many outside scholarships that by the end, I got a refund check, basically.
Nice.
And without loans. And so when I got to Howard, I met a friend in Drew Hall. And I'm thinking, okay, we finna be cool. You know, you make your plan. You know, we gonna do this together. And then he couldn't return our sophomore year purely because of financials, or because he didn't have the financial aid. And so I was so devastated and heartbroken by that, because there's more than enough money out here. And this person is more than capable, super intelligent, super duper qualified, but yet he has to leave and he doesn't get to continue. When that didn't have to be the case. So I followed my big brother, his lead, because he has a nonprofit in Alabama called Starseeds. And so I kind of followed his lead and what he was doing and created my own situation. And our motto, or our philosophy, is we don't just give scholarships out. We also teach you where to find scholarships and how to apply. This idea that if you teach a man a fish, he'll eat forever. So understanding that if I teach you how to find it, then you'll always be able to go out and get what it is that you need, and then hopefully pass that information along. And we've been pretty successful. Beyond myself, there's been at least two other students who have been able to fully fund their education on the scholarships as well. So it's been really, really awesome, amazing. And that's how it happened.
And that's beautiful. Like I said, I mean, hey, I'm a kid that I didn't even know how it was until I got there. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so having a situation like that and being having support systems like yours with people that look like you who are recently going through the same experience as you and have the same hurt as you, right? Like, you look and you know, you remember that freshman year, they say, look around. You just know that they may not be people.
They're not be there.
By the time you graduate, you know what I'm saying? And I didn't really have the magnitude of that word. I didn't understand the magnitude of those words until I looked around and there were less and less people around me, you know? So it's beautiful what you're doing to kind of ensure that the next freshmen don't really have to go through that same hurt, or maybe know the resources to, you know, mitigate that hurt as well. So now to move on to you specifically, right? 2019 comes around. Year before COVID, you didn't even know that's going on, right? You're finally ready to graduate. Your single drops, right? Reality to Be. The art cover is beautiful. The rollout is beautiful. Everything is just immaculate. What was it like to debut? And why was this the song that you want to debut as your professional singing and music career?
Yeah, that's a great question. Reality to Be. So I was in class and this guy, you're in class and everybody in there does different things in music, of course. So this guy named Destin, he was in class and he was talking about he was a producer. So I was like, hey, bro, we got to link up. I want to hear some of your stuff. I write, you produce, let's see what we can do. He said, you know what? I got a track. I think you know, I've been wanting somebody to get, put some ears to. I'm like, okay, bet. So I go and he had already written a song. I forgot the name of the song that he wrote, but he had already written a song over it. And he was like, just see what you can do with that. Maybe write a verse. I said, okay. So I ended up writing a verse and a chorus.
Nice.
So then he was like, okay, this sounds good. Well, how about you sing this part? I'll sing this part. I'm like, all right, that's a bit. Then I went back. He was like, I kind of don't like my verse no more. Like, you know, yours is kind of good. Can you write me a verse? I was like, yeah, I got you. So I wrote a verse and I wrote a bridge and I wrote it. So he was like, you know, bro, you can have it. And I was like, okay, bet, you know. So that's how it came to be. A reality to be is because at first I was writing about a dream. And dreams just seem so kind of not necessarily unobtainable, but it just seems fantasy. So I was like, it's not a dream. It's I was like, it's reality to be. It's the reality that I just yet to materialize or yet to walk into. So that's where that came from. And I wrote it, put it together, we recorded it. Actually took, it's funny because I put the song down for like a year, didn't like it, didn't want to mess with it. Then picked it back up, made some more changes, made some more edits, and then decided to go ahead and roll out with it, and was able to put together a really awesome music video. Malika did an awesome job. Different people came together and helped me out. A lot of my friends are in those videos. We filmed over at Sankofa.
Right, dope.
And it was cool. It was awesome.
That's
awesome
great
debut.
And then and as I'm saying, ever since then, you know, you got three singles as well that you have on all DSPs right now: Preordained, Price of Peace, and Beautiful. That's the most recent single as well. Which one of these three do you kind of, or I guess all eras of RB3, or how do you kind of define where these singles kind of place in your career?
How do I define it in my career? Man, okay. I don't know if I can define it for my career. I would say they're all the beginning, you know. They're all just, you know, really at the beginning. But with Preordained, someone very close to me was just venting to me one day, and I felt so helpless. I felt so defeated because that's how they felt. And I wanted to just encourage them and tell them that it's going to be all right. I just wanted them to believe me and hear me when I say, like, it's going to be all right. Like, I can't solve your issue. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I can't fix it. But I just, it hurt me so bad that they were so hurt. So I wrote that song. I was on a bus, actually, on my way from Bakersfield, California to L.A., which is like a two-hour bus ride.
Yeah,
I wrote
right.
that whole song in that two-hour bus ride because I was so heavy, so full. I literally went on YouTube. I found an instrumental, and I literally just was in my phone and my notes just crying and typing and writing and doing my own little thing in my little seat. So that's how Preordained came to be. And I was on my way to fly to my buddy X's house, and I recorded it when I got to his house. So I got to his house. I was like, bro, I gotta lay this down. And I recorded it there. And then I was blessed. One of my professors from Howard, actually, she agreed to feature on the track, as well as another person I look up to, who's a dope vocalist, Tyree, on Preordained. So that was super that she respected my artistry enough to join me on that. That was dope. Shakira Rogers. She's dope. Check her out. And so that's Preordained, Reality to Be, Price of Peace. My granddaddy passed away. So RB3, this my granddaddy is RB, the original, right? He's the first.
Yeah, right.
And it could be no three if there was not one. And I just, again, music is how I cope. It's how I process. It's all those things. And so that song was an assignment. The music that you hear was started as an assignment that we had in class where we had to write these chords. We had to write these chords and put this arrangement together. And so that's it was an assignment. But then later on, I took those same chords and all those things that I wrote. And I took kind of like a prayer, but kind of like me just venting and kind of like, you know, just when I wrote it, I was sitting in my car because I didn't want to be in the house. I didn't want my brother seeing me cry. I didn't want my mom seeing me cry.
Right.
So I just went and sat in the car away from everybody and was just being open and honest about what I felt, what I didn't know if I felt, what I didn't know if it was okay to feel, didn't know if I should feel that way. And so Price of Peace was born out of that because, you know, as much as, and which is honestly my most transparent or most vulnerable song that I've written up to this point about the most, I guess, the lowest time of my life thus far when my grandfather passed away. So that was Price of Peace. And then my same granddaddy for his birthday last year, I released Beautiful, which starts with a clip of him singing from Thanksgiving. We played games at Thanksgiving. So he was singing like Song Association. He was singing at Thanksgiving. So I took that clip and I sent it to my producer and he was able to take it and kind of loop it and build a track off of it. So it's kind of like me and my granddad get to duet. And, Yeah. So that's kind of how that one came to be.
And that's beautiful. Like I said, like it's there's a need for this type of music right now in this industry, as I believe. Like it's the music that kind of makes you give you that long sigh at the end of the day. You know, like when the weight of the world is bearing on your shoulders, this is what you should be listening to, right? To kind of allow that release that have, and it comes from a place of catharsis as you're explaining, right? Like that's why for me, like I said, listening to this music in that stressful moment of even missing my bus, that's not as, you know, dramatic as losing a loved one or going through like your lowest time. But even in those moments, right, of agitation, of irritability, this is the music that we need. So now that I say that, there's a bunch of singles I see out here on my lap. Are we gonna get an EP? Are we gonna get an album? Are we gonna when am I gonna get this? Or because we definitely are gonna have this date again. This is gonna be a second date. So okay, I'm gonna have to talk about an album when that date happens.
Okay. Yeah, I hear you. Yes, I do have some more music. Yes, I have been writing. Yes, I do want to release a project. When? That's a great question. I don't want to put no date on it, because then I'm gonna be stuck to. I'm gonna have to keep my word. Yeah, I just know it's in the works, and not only just that, but some merchandise. I've been learning again about, like I said, the business aspect that doesn't stop. It's always continuing to grow, and what I'm learning is that you have to build assets that will create your wealth. And so what I'm doing now is I'm taking various lyrics from these songs, and I'm creating shirts and different types of merchandise that someone who is aware of the song will be like, oh, this is super dope. But someone who has never heard of the song could still be attracted to the message, or still identify with what is being, you know, being shared or communicated via this image or via this, you know, whatever piece of merchandise. So I will have some more merchandise to push as well. And but yes, absolutely. And I'm gonna say this, what's coming up next is gonna be more of a traditional R&B neo soul feel. A lot of the stuff that you've heard thus far has been very fusion. But now I want to do some, I mean, of course I can't run from gospel. It's just you can hear a little gospel every time I sing.
I mean, it's in your vibrato, it's already there.
It's exactly where it's at. That's what you can thank the gospel choir for that piece too. But yeah, that's where we're moving to. That's where we're moving to.
And that's beautiful. That's beautiful. Like I said, and honestly, RB3, thank you so much for coming in and kicking me, man. Like, do you have any final words, any final pieces of wisdom or things you'd like to share about yourself or anything you'd like to share with the audience before we head out of here?
Absolutely. Well, before I give them that, I just want to say thank you for having me. Thank you for being prepared. Thank you for having some really insightful questions. Thank you for keeping it fun. Thank you for creating this platform and sharing and really giving people an opportunity to share and to kind of get some of the pieces that folks don't really get on a regular basis, you know. So I appreciate you and I applaud you for what you're doing, bro. And what I would say to the people is, where I am right now is just be. A lot of times we spend so much time and energy trying to do this or trying to achieve that or trying to, you know, take on this identity or that identity, when you simply just exist and you just be who you are and your most authentic self. And you allow, I made a caption the other day and I said, you can't control the sunlight, but you can't open the blinds. When you allow that inner light to just shine and stop blocking it out of, you know, concern for what these people going to say or what those people are going to do or trying to get a certain number of likes or followers. When you just simply be, that everything that is meant for you, every person is supposed to hear your message, every person is supposed to be attracted to your camp, your community, your team, they will come. But it all starts with you just simply being who you are.
And that's beautiful. You should write a book, man. I'm saying, you need
to... Oh, yeah, a little book. I might do a little book. We gonna see.
I'm saying, you just do a little one. Maybe you gotta do a big one.
Yeah. A little PDF something, right? Give me an email. I might send it to you free. I got you.
All right. But, thank you, RB3, for coming in once again and sharing your story, sharing your narrative, and sharing your soul, bearing your soul to us as well, and letting us in a little bit into that little home that you call your personality. And thank you so much for coming on my show and doing that. Thank you.
Man, thank you again for having me.
Of course. And obviously to you guys watching this interview, you guys can check out my boy RB3 at RB3 Artistry. And that's obviously RB3, not three I's on Instagram, RB3 Artistry on Instagram. You can check him out, and RB3 and all DSPs right now. If you are in Marietta, I believe, If you're in Marietta, you guys can check him out, RB3 Academy. If you guys got kids, or even for yourself, you guys want to get any vocal trainings or any instrumentalist training, please hit him up. He is amazing. Thank you once again, RB3. You guys can check out this interview on Instagram and YouTube at the DC Voice. Once again, I'm your host, Kachi the Analyst. Thank you once again. We're out of here. Peace.
Peace.